确立多元参与角色，保障 AI 应用发挥最大效果。主要包括四类关键角色参与角色：第一，监督者用户是监督、指导未成年人使用 AI 应用的用户，包括但不限于教师、父母和其他法定监护人。未成年人用户是 AI 应用的直接使用者。第三， AI 应用服务提供者是开展未成年人 AI 应用的设计、开发、运营和维护等活动的个人和组织。最后， AI 应用服务评估者是评估未成年人 AI 应用是否符合疫区目的相关政策法规和标准要求，评估未成年人 AI 应用对未成年人的影响的个人和组织，包括自建评估组织、第三方评估机构等。 我们也可以看一看这个，在未成年人使用，在未成年 AI 应用的具体建设上，标准划分了 AI 应用的生成周期关键阶段，同时从避免不公平、隐私和数据安全、净化网络环境、关注身心发展四个方面出发，我们提出了识别相应风险、确立数据范围、强调技术可塑、清理不良信息等具体的建议。 助力行业精准定位要点，少走弯路。结合常见的未成年人 AI 应用场景 ，AI 应用特有的关键阶段包括数据获取、已准备阶段、模型设计、已开发阶段、测试验证、已评估阶段和模型部署的已使用阶段，且上述关键阶段。 在 AI 应用的生成周期中，会持续不断的迭代优化。中国常见的8种未成年人 AI 应用，我们也进行了梳理，放在目录。然后我们在标准中也给出了被未成年人 AI 应用设计和开发的4个方面的建议措施。首先，针对未成年人在 AI 应用设计和开发的4个方面措施，首先， 针对未成年人 AI 应用可能存在的对未成年人的不公平风险，建设措施如下：使用高低使用高质量的数据集，保障数据所代表的客观公正性、关联性和适性；第二，保障数据获取来源可信、多元可追溯。我们也可以，第三，人工干预矫正；第四，清晰、 明了的提示 AI 的影响。其次，需要保护未成年人的个人隐私和数据安全。建设措施包括：第一，针对未成年人进行单独进行隐私声明，及时删除和屏蔽；使用匿名化数据、淘汰、加密、可信计算环境、联邦学习、迁移学习等技术方法；设置家长模式， 引入专业第三方机构进行风险评估。第三，在净化未成年人网络方面，我们相关建设措施：第一，履行防沉迷义务，包括智能提醒、使用时长等；二，通过 AI 技术识别未成年人用户月前使用的使用互联网应用的时间管理、权限管理、消费管理等功能；第三，通过 AI 技术识别文字、图像和视频， 对可能影响未成年人身心健康的信息予以标注，并给予显著的提示。在线教育 AI 应用，不插入网络游戏链接，不推送广告等与教学无关信息。第四，在关注未成年人身心发展下，建议措施如下：一、加强未成年人的素养教育宣传教育，对目标用户群体不限 不仅限于未成年人的 AI 应用，开设未成年人专区和开启未成年人模式；第三，建立用户易于理解和使用的功能模块和业务流程，如智能语音识别功能、智能文字和图像识别功能、智能推荐等功能。最后，期待与行业同仁们一起，结合标准展开更多有益的尝试与合作，凝聚 总结未成年人 AI 应用的智慧和经验，让科技更好地守护未成年人的美好未来。 我的汇报到此结束，谢谢大家的聆听，谢谢。
Thank you, Mr. Huang. Just now, he provided detailed explanations about the Children's Internet Application Guide based on artificial intelligence technology. Today, our organizing committee invites two international experts and scholars to comment on the draft industry standard. First, welcome Eleanor Powells, who is an AI case documentation consultant for UNICEF.
Ladies and gentlemen, dear experts and dear colleagues, it is a great pleasure to share some remarks with you today to review CFIS draft guidelines for the construction of internet applications for minors based on AI technology. And I would like to thank you for this opportunity. Let me start by saying that the guidelines you produced embody a compelling and excellent effort to provide critical safeguards for the protection of minors in a domain, AI, which is very young,and difficult to map, govern, and control. Of course, in an emerging tech domain, responsible governance is both a collective journey and a work in progress, and therefore there are always areas and practices that can be improved or reinforced, and I will cover those later in my remarks. So let me start with the strengths and the very positive elements of the CFIS draft guidelines. First,The guidelines elicit general principles of responsible innovation for protecting minor users, such as fairness and non-discrimination, transparency and inclusiveness of AI technology in internet applications. Interestingly, the guidelines also encourage new collaborations between public and private sector actors across the AI industry to enable a form of collective, inclusive co-governance.Second, the guidelines mention the importance of performing iterative testing, assessment and audits through all critical stages, in the life cycle of AI applications. In particular, the guidelines underscore how crucial it is for professional, independent, third-party agencies to conduct risk and impact assessments to prevent and mitigate the potential negative effects that AI applications may have on minors.Third, the authors of the guidelines are correct to address the question of quality, fairness, and representativity of data sets used in the training of algorithmic models for internet applications. The guidelines underline the need to employ high-quality data sets to ensure data availability, reliability, and credibility, and to avoid reflecting prejudices and biases.They also stress the importance of including all relevant data types so that the data sets can fully represent all relevant situations, issues, and user groups. Another important point in the guidelines is to remind AI engineers and service providers about the importance of ensuring traceability, including the need to provide qualitative assessment of technical models, performance of algorithms, and data sets. Fourth,The guidelines mention the importance of mitigating the impact of the digital divide, as well as considering the impact of AI applications on the physical and mental development of minors. And this aspect is critical, as excessive automation in minors' relationships might reduce the opportunity for social interaction and might impact and actually polarize relationships. Now let me jump to the areas and practices that may need to be reinforced,or improved. The guidelines could have a stronger and more in-depth focus on what it means and takes to implement minor-centered design for AI applications. The guidelines could require service providers to conduct upstream ethical and impact assessment that would include meaningful participation of minors as well as experts in child rights and child protection. Across AI applications, it is also crucial.To create the conditions for the participation of underserved and vulnerable groups of minors. Second, data protection and management. The guidelines could require a more robust assessment of the purpose, necessity, and proportionality principles in data collection and algorithmic models. They could offer additional recommendations about the types of safeguards that service providers should apply to conform to these principles in the life cycle management of data that concern minors. When it comes to minors' sensitive information, including biometrics, behavioral, and health data, it is important to consider whether the processing of such information about minors should be prohibited or only allowed in very limited context. Overall, the guidelines should recommend that service providers share in child-friendly language their policies about data ownership, data management and privacy, and be fully clear and transparent about selling or sharing of minors' data to third-party entities. Third, advances in data processing and algorithmic profiling pose novel threats to group privacy. To protect the group privacy, service providers should integrate two recommendations. Conduct algorithmic impact assessments, measuring the outcomes of the AI model on groups, as well as potential collective data harms, and disclose the data and source code behind algorithmic models that could be considered as imposing a high-risk burden on certain population subgroups. Finally, we increasingly see emerging several types of online abuses, which may constitute serious violations of child rights and child protection principles. They include targeted digital marketing, online harassment, and child sexual exploitation and abuse. The guidelines could recommend specific detection, monitoring, reporting, and remedial mechanisms to be implemented by service providers and help guide them in managing the technical trade-offs that come with those specific protection mechanisms. With these last words, I will be closing my intervention and thank you for this opportunity to share insights on the draft CFIS guidelines. Many thanks again for your attention.
Welcome, Andre.
Yes, thank you for giving me this opportunity to participate in this forum. I want to say something about the online child exploitation and effective standard setting to protect our children. So what is the context? Children start using online tools, such as devices and being exposed to online content at a much earlier stage in their life than they did in the past. When we look at the statistics that we collect in Australia, about 10% of children use electronic devices at an age of only 4 years. Now, the global pandemic has accelerated this process through the wide use of home and online schooling for age groups as early as preparation grade. So that would be about year five. It's also called preschool, for example, in other countries. In Australia specifically, study of exploitation was conducted at the national level by a special organization. Our family participated in this study as we had a child in the relevant age group. And as we hope to gain a better understanding of what was unique to our circumstances and what other families would experience with their children when they ventured online. So in this short talk, I relate to some of the key findings of the study conducted by the Australian Centre to Counter Child Exploitation that was published in 2020 and is based on data from 2019. So this is one thing that you should keep in mind because obviously the global pandemic also had like a major impact on how the behavior of children online changed since then. So the study has since been widely used by the Australian government bodies to develop relevant policies to better protect our children from online exploitation by organizations and individuals. And importantly, who are often criminal in nature. And this is a particular concern and also needs to be considered when implementing or setting a standard. So what are some of the key findings of the research study? My aim is to briefly discuss the set of the studies and then to highlight some of the findings that are of particular concern. So the sample size of the quantitative study was about 2,559 respondents across Australia, and for the qualitative study, it was 159 participants that were included in the study. So the sample covered all Australian states, including, and that's, I think, a very important, the smaller states such as the Northern Territory and Tasmania. So the Northern Territory, where the biggest fraction of a population is Aboriginal, so the native indigenous people of Australia. So gaining of a better understanding of the exploitation of Aboriginal children is particularly important, as this community is very vulnerable, as it has shown in the past, and it has in the past experienced problems such as early alcohol consumption and abuse, and also the widely documented problem of a petrol sniffing that particularly was dangerous for the development of children, as it potentially damages the functioning of the brain and really has like a severe health implications. So the results show strong trends with age, somewhat surprising as the study was conducted before the pandemic in April, May 2019. So even at that time, we saw like a strong trends in how the behavior of children changed from the early stage of like 4 to up to 17, 18 years of age. So children in the study were covering 14 to 18 years, and the striking finding is that a small majority of parents, by the time their child turns 8, already feel or felt that they were less knowledgeable about online tools, technology than their children. So this is, I find quite astonishing that the parents who are adults feel disadvantaged relative to the knowledge that they have about the technology that their children are using at an age of 8. Then the age trends also to show that the younger children predominantly use tablets, whereas older children move to smartphones and increase the time they're spending online. So the statistics before the pandemic were for the age group of 16 to 18 years old, that on average the kids would spend 4 hours per day. And imagining that they spend that predominantly on smartphones, it also becomes obvious that it's very hard for parents to see what exactly their children are doing online. And it also shows the importance and the necessity of industry bodies, the government and regulatory organizations to make sure that the standards are there, and also help to better monitor what is going on and what activities and exposures these children experience. It would be interesting to match these statistics with online app usage that are collected by some of the content delivery network providers, internet usage tracking companies, and the telecommunication providers, such as Tencent, as we have heard from before. For privacy reasons, this is a difficult undertaking, but I think there need to be ways be found to make some of these data more accessible, so that the standards implementation are also more focused and successful. So what are some of the implications for the standard setting organizations such as the International Organization of Standardization or in Australia, Standards Australia, our country level body? A common misperception is that the standard indicates how a process must be done. So usually when we set the standard, we word this in the form that the things are recommended or should be done in a certain way, because I think that also in practice has worked better. So it's really a guideline on how to do things rather than an order. So that seems to work better in our practice. Standard settings regarding protecting our children are very difficult since children often do not understand why certain online exposures could be bad for them. This is accentuated by the fact that children often see themselves in control of their technological savviness, but do not understand the psychological damage, online abuse, bullying, and belittlement they're potentially exposed to and could fall victim to. And obviously most problematic is things such as sexual exploitation of children. And it's interesting when one watches how children use, for example, online games such as Roblox, how they interact or have an opportunity to interact with people that they really don't know. So, and there it is problematic when the parents do not understand exactly how their children are potentially exposed to people that they even don't know in person. So what are some of the future directions? So much work lies ahead to translate research insights into meaningful standards that also can be effectively and implemented in our practice. For this, this study, for example, is a helpful tool because it also connects some of the empirical statistics with more the theoretical implementation and then execution of the standards to then be rolled out in our practice. So it is one thing to set standards for organization. It is an entirely different challenge to develop standards that can serve to protect our children from the ever greater risks of online child exploitation. This is all I wanted to present. So thank you again for your attention.
Thank you, Andrew. The last speaker in today's session is Dora Justi, who is the chief of the Child Protection Division, UNICEF China. We'll give a speech to conclude the meeting. Welcome our old friend Dora.
Thank you. Ms. Zhao Wei, Mr. Zhou Shangfang, Mr. Duan Peng, and distinguished panelists and participants and guests. As UNICEF China, we're very happy to be back at IGF this year, together with China Federation of Internet Society, as we have done before. For me personally and for UNICEF China, it is a pleasure to close this important event today. Which presented the draft industry standards related to child protection and AI. As mentioned by other speakers, these standards were launched as guidelines of the China Federation of Internet Society as standards for members, group standards, in relation to protection of children in the construction of internet apps using AI technology. And as UNICEF and as partners of this event, I would like to commend the efforts of all the parties involved in this draft standards and in these guidelines. The China Federation of Internet Society, Tencent Communication of University of China, and many other experts and companies. These guidelines focus on how to apply ethics, safety, child-centered principle to the design and implementation of internet application based on algorithm systems. These guidelines were also inspired by the 2021 UNICEF Policy Guidance for Children, and as Eleanor, our expert, defined, there are many strengths, and as everything that is in process, there are also aspects that we can continue working on. I would like to remind, as we close this session, of the 9 key principles of the UNICEF policy guidance on AI for children. And the first one is support children's development and well-being. The second, ensure inclusion on, of, and for children. Prioritize fairness and non-discrimination for children. Fourth, protect children's data and privacy. Fifth, ensure safety for children. Sixth, empower government and businesses with knowledge of AI and children's rights. Prepare children for present and future developments in AI and create an enabling environment. Although all these principles are important and interlinked, and they need to be reflected upon in any efforts that we promote on AI for children, I would like today, as we close this session, to stress 3 principles that are often more complex to implement and that some of the speakers have pointed out too. The first one is the need to ensure child-centered design in the entire life cycle of AIs by ensuring the participation of children as well as of other experts and actors. The second one is the need to protect children's data and privacy, looking at managing sensitive data, management of anonymity, and group privacy as well as data ownership, among others. And third is the need to identify child protection risks. We've just heard a presentation focusing on that, and how we use innovation and technology to address some of these issues. For example, if we need to use the use of image screen systems rather than encryption. I believe this is a journey, and today it's the first step or one of the key steps of this ambitious journey that will take us into transforming these association standards into more ambitious industry and national standards that will apply to all information, communication, and technology companies. And as we embark in this journey, we have to take into consideration these elements, these nuances. And to do so, we need participation of even more studies, more experts, more companies to analyze other similar efforts, to compare, to learn from each other. And also, include different views and make sure that these standards are strong and a model even for other standards. UNICEF China will be glad to provide the child rights lens and to share good practices, to be a bridge between practices in some other countries and the practices developed in China. The UN Committee on the Rights of the Child, in its General Comment number 25, recognized that AI is becoming increasingly important across most aspects of children's lives. It offers new opportunities for the realization of children's rights, but also poses the risk of their violation of abuse. To avoid these risks, we need to ensure that 3 P's, that's how they're called, of the UNICEF policy guidance are met. The first one is provision, do good. So the AI has to benefit the children in an equal way, respecting everyone's rights and bringing development and equity. The second is protection, do no harm. We do not expose children, do not want to expose children to any risks. And the third one is participation. We need to include children in all stages of AI, including in the development, testing, and the implementation and assessment of impact. And we need to make sure that we include the children that are often excluded. Together, we can build a safer digital world for children. And today, we are taking a very important step towards this goal. Let me thank again all panelists, the participants, CFIS, IGF, for this successful event, and look forward to working together even more to create a safe digital world for children. Thank you.
Thank you, Dora. And in the end, we might have taken some questions depending on the time. And I have seen many attendees have put the questions in the comment areas, and I will choose 2. The first question is to Andrew from University of Melbourne. Hello, Andrew. You mentioned that Austrian government bodies have developed policies to better protect children from online exploitation. Could you please introduce briefly to us on the specific measures taken by Austrian government to implement these policies? Can these policies be better implemented by using AI? Thank you, Andrew.
Yes, thank you. I think the policies potentially can be better implemented by using AI, because it is important to understand what the specific exposure of children is. And for example, at schools, so during the pandemic, it was shown that really the time that the children spent on the internet increased dramatically. And so obviously this had big negative implications for their learning progress because of a lack of a concentration and so. And in this context, basically the policies that we had with working with children sort of have been moved forward to also include to a much greater extent how we deal or interact with children in the online space rather than just the physical world. And one possible tool is, for example, time limits that are imposed on devices. So when children at school are using devices, so they can use certain apps only for limited time. Now here is a little bit a call for the tech sector. Apple, for example, has like this feature that you can set a time block, but the way these features presently are designed is a little bit problematic because they're not very flexible. So you can not really fine tune the settings to the actual needs that are required, to protect the children's. So that will be something that will be very much appreciated by the government bodies and also by the educators, because that really would help to better protect the children. And that I can also tell that from my own experience with having a child, where this was an ongoing struggle to set time limits to effectively monitor the behavior.
Thank you, Andrew. Thank you for your answer. The second question is to Dora from UNICEF China. Dear Dora, what is the role of the information communication and technology companies in terms of ensuring child participation in the design and implementation of applications using AI technology? Thank you, Dora.
Thank you for the question. Well, as I said, it's one of the key principles of the policy guidance. And I think companies that are investing in technology to develop AI for children should, first of all, conduct research and understand involving children directly and using all these ethical measures. What are the patterns of behavior, like Andrew was describing on the internet, how are they using it? What are the challenges, risks they're facing? What do they need to know? Then there has to be also an involvement in the design, since we need to have also child-centered approach in all in the design. We need to involve them also in what they think, in a way, obviously, that is child-friendly, that is accessible to them. And we need to also understand with children the impact that what we have created is having on children. So we need to, the companies would need to embed really this element into the whole life cycle of the AI, from the design, the thinking, the design, the implementation, and the impact. And to do so, it's important also to have the right expertise to make sure the ethical measures and codes of conduct are kept in mind, and also which is more of a challenge, how we involve children that are most excluded, maybe from even access to the internet and to digital apps. Thank you.
Thank you, Dora. The last question is to Mr. Huang from Tencent. Hello, speaker from Tencent. Can you explain briefly about the value of AI standardization to AI technology and industrial development? 就是黄老师能不能简单介绍一下，就是AI 标准化工作对于 AI 技术和产业发展的价值？黄老师。
好，那个谢谢，那个我替黄老师来回答哈，那个腾讯的李克鹏啊，就是我是专门负责这个就是标准化工作的，然后我从事标准化工作也是10多年了，然后我来谈谈对这个问题的理解，就是概括来说呢 ，AI 标准化工作的价值主要是两个方面，护航和领航。首先是护航方面，主要是通过制定 AI 安全合规的标准，促进 AI 技术的科技向善，因为 AI 技术需要在安全可靠。 可控的基础上来进行发展。目前，我国的这个主管部门在 AI 的算法安全、数据安全、个人信息保护等方面都有监管合规的要求，而 AI 的安全标准可以用于细化和落实监管要求，促进行业自律，提升整个 AI 行业的安全能力和规范化水平，为 AI 行业的健康发展保驾护航。比如咱们今天发布的这个团体标准，就是科技向善的一个很好的例子。其次是在领航方面。 主要是指通过制定 AI 技术方面的标准，实现标准引领，促进 AI 向上。因为 AI 是一个创新驱动的技术领域，我们可以通过标准把产学研用等各方的优秀实践形成共识，沉淀下来，并推广开来，促进产业链的互联互通、提质增效等，从而带动整个行业的技术创新，促进 AI 技术进一步向上发展。在标准实践方面。 腾讯也一直在践行科技向善的理念和价值观，并积极将自身在科技向善的实践通过技术白皮书、标准等形式推广到行业中。展望未来，腾讯也将继续秉承 AI 向善和 AI 向上的理念，与业界同仁一起积极推进标准共建与落地应用，发挥 AI 价值的作用和价值。好，谢谢大家。
Thank you, Mr. Lee. Mr. Lee is also from Tencent Company and he's the expert of the standard writing team. Thank you very much. Thanks to all attendees today and thank you for your questions and the experts' excellent explanations. The forum develops a common understanding of how we can maximize the opportunities the internet offers and how we can use it for the benefit of all nations and peoples and how we can address risks and challenges. One particular area of hope, but also of concern, is the relationship of children and young people to the internet. And the internet has opened new doors for them to knowledge and culture. Yet, it can also present a threat to their safety. The topic of this year's meeting has a strong focus on the protection of children, and I hope that it will contribute to making them safer. In the end, thanks to all of you for your attention and your time. I appreciate it very much. But now, I'm sorry to say that today's conference will have to end here. So see you next year. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Andrew,
bye.
Andrew,
bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Andrew. Thank you.
Bye. Bye.